Senator Joachim Henry.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you. And I must confess, today is indeed a historical day. A very, very historical day. To listen to the contributions from the leader of government business on this side on the matter of Sabbath keeping. But permit me to say a prayerful good afternoon to everybody. And of course, I would also like to, though it belated, greet everybody. Happy Independence Day. I still believe that we are in the independence fervor. I also like to join the Mr. President and acknowledge condolences to Sir Dwight Venner's family, as well as permit me to recognize a policeman officer who had passed, Shakon, of great service, and also we had a gentleman who normally calls the talk show, one Matthew Lubin, who always promote Cuba in his contribution on afternoons, who has passed from Lakwa. And I also would like to recognize those fallen persons who have contributed service, consistent service to St. Lucia. Permit me also, Mr. President, to thank the Parliament for the 2 days workshop that I participated in. I think it was informative, and I left with some information, but two that stays on my mind. One, that we are all equal in this Parliament, and two, that the UK Parliament recognizes that the position of Deputy Speaker is so important that there are two. In St. Lucia, we have none. But let me move on to my substantive contribution. I ask myself the question, why was it necessary after election to bring a bill in this House to avoid nomination day, not election day, as the leader of government business have mentioned? Nomination day is what is before us, not election day. Pas jour election, jour nomination. And it's important that we make the distinction between the two, because nomination day is for a few persons who witness and the candidates who would be participating in election. Election day is for the persons, for the entire. Those persons who want to have the fanfare and bring in the motorcade to go and nominate, that's a different thing, but you do not have to do this. As a matter of fact, the Act for Nomination provides alternative measures where you could have somebody else to go for you. Proxy method. But leave that. I ask why. Mr. President, let me prepare the context of my contribution by saying a few things. I believe that this government on this side is in problems. This government has a lot of problems on its hands and cannot deal with the problems, and would like to distract this nation from important matters. And I'll tell you why. Remember Five to Stay Alive? It's dead. Ching ching in your pocket, kote. Bread in your basket, pain pain. They're sending the people of St. Lucia to go and get water in a basket. We had a plans for St. Lucia, none. The plans are not on the ground. As a matter of fact, the Prime Minister spends more time in the air. So are the plans. PS plan, who pay is at least. They promise transparency. Transparency. Where's the transparency? Complain about leaks. And I've asked a question, a simple question, about the terms of reference. And the leader of government business used the opportunity to confirm that the documents that's out there in social media would provide me with the answer, so to speak. Well, of course, I noticed that the member on this side have a way of validating what is in social media, what is on the internet. You are skillful in showing that. But I do not rely on what is on social media. I would like the business of St. Lucia to be pronounced in this house. That's why I asked the question. But of course you choose to take me to social media. It is indeed a familiar place that I choose not to be. So we talk about investigating civil servants and what have you. But I tell you, this government is starting to major in minors. Petty stuff. So here are the five building blocks of what I consider to be this government approach, maybe to seduce the religions of this country. It first started with visiting all the churches during the campaign. Let's visit all of the churches. It's a ground where we can get votes. And I visited Tutleglis. Number two, mock the sacraments and the mass of the Catholic Church to win an election. That's what I saw our Prime Minister did. Your moche sacrement avec mass l'église catholique pour gain election. Troisième, it was announced, you are now say, and Jacques Mel, let us close the gap between church and state by the honorable member for ancillary counties. The most dangerous statement I've heard from a politician in recent times. Let us close the gap between church and state. That was number three. Number four, pass a piece of legislation to show the church that we are care and concern about the opportunity to go to church on nomination day. But for who? Not for the nation, for the politicians who want to present themselves to represent this country. As a Seventh-day Adventist, when I decided that I would put myself up to participate in elective politics, I knew that it would take me from my comfort station. I knew that there are nights if the storm come, I would have to go out. I knew that putting myself up calls for more than just being a politician. You are a leader. And when we know for a fact that the Prime Minister did not deliberately put nomination day on Saturday, we know that for a fact. He gave an explanation. After all, how many elections we have had that has happened? Of course, we are Christian people, and do you give the benefit of the doubt? Of course, no. But of course, the Lord's Prayer says, forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. But we are too judgmental to do that. And therefore, we pray a lot. But you know what Mahatma Gandhi talk about praying? Few words and more, and a heart is better than a lot of words with no heart. So when you pray, keep your words few and have a heart that cares. But what we do? We come here to play religion at the next level. Let me give you the fifth one. But I'll come back to the fourth one of religious observance. I'll give you the fifth one. To publicly announce in the House of Parliament that the churches does better under us was the crowning statement of this government. It was said by the member for Castries Southeast. Oh, when people went to church, they were worried looking at the pastors. For once, we are now politicizing the churches when we say that the churches do better under a particular party. And could you define what you mean by better? Are they receiving monies? Are they praying more because we have more crimes? What is it that we're talking about better? That statement should not be in our parliament. But I tell you, instead of five stay alive, I've provided you with five important reasons as to where this government is going with churches. Visit them. Mock them. Announce that you will have a good relationship, a cozy relationship with them. Then come in this house and pretend you're passing legislation so that they will go to church. And the fifth one is to say that they are better under us. Five to stay alive? Five. But take history, Mr. President, and ask me what has happened to the world when the church and state was one. Inquisition. People were burned to the stake. People did not have a freedom of conscience. Now let me tell you, I was comfortable that I was doing the right thing. You know why? I consulted my pastors. I consulted my pastors both here and overseas. I consulted them. You know what some of them said? Brother, I cannot tell you what to do. I understand what it is, but you have to make that decision. With the freedom of conscience, I made a decision I felt in the interest of the people of this country. You cannot legislate morality, because the Bible that speaks of the Sabbath says, if you're guilty of one, you're guilty of all. So don't come and pretend that you're trying to allow people to save the Sabbath and then fornication and adultery goes by. No, not in this country of ours, not to the children inside of here. You see, the principle of keeping God's law resides on a principle called love. Love your people. I love the Sabbath, but I love my people more. I will not sit at my home knowing that I want to represent St. Lucia and the storm is raging and I tell my wife, well, of course, it's the Sabbath. Not at all. When I get to heaven, I'll have to ask God some questions, but I'll tell you, while on earth, I will do what I think is right. Now, I'm surprised that on this side where there are Seventh-day Adventists coming with this, but it tells me more about the leader of the party than of the individuals. But I'll tell you, nobody could get me to support piece of legislation like this. So, what it is? There are some statements I wish to make reference to. There's a book the Seventh-day Adventists reads. They read it. The Great Controversy, page 1. And it says, to protect liberty of conscience is the duty of the state. This is the limit of its authority in the matters of religion. Every secular government that attempts to regulate and enforce religious observance by civil authority is sacrificing the very principle for which evangelical Christians so nobly struggled. I will also make a statement from a gentleman, from a man that I think is very important, and that's from, you know, JF Kennedy said that we should keep, he wants America to remain separate from the church. He said, and let me get it right, Mr. President, because I do not want to in any way mislead this very important house, but I want St. Lucians to think carefully at what is happening in this country, our St. Lucia, in St. Lucia. He said, I believe in America where the separation of church and state is absolute, where religious liberty is so indivisible that an act against one church is treated as an act against all. Remarks in Greater Houston Ministerial Association, September 12, 1960, John F. Kennedy. Separation between church and state. I usually stay at church, Mr. President, and I disagree sometimes with so much at the Adventist Church. I tell them what I believe. I am humbled by the fact that I believe in certain things that I can relate to Catholics and other religions on. That is to love our people. Love St. Lucia. If St. Lucia is at war with a country, Saturday, Sunday, whatever day it is, I will be on the battlefield with my people. That's me, Joachim Henry. I don't know what we want to profess and what shots we want to call to our people or whether we want to seduce them into a religious nation that speaks more of words but have no heart. You just fired all, gave all the people on working on nice a letter telling them they are dismissed by March 31st at the time when you're celebrating independence. Where's the love? You take $1 million, you go and spend for an audit. The audit, the document I see out there cannot even catch a rat in town, far less arrest a minister. You want to take all the lands and give it to Chinese for horse racing that cannot give a cent to St. Lucians? There's so many biblical examples that would chastise us and tell us what we're doing is wrong. But today, you want to come and present to this house a piece of legislation that deals with it. That's unprecedented. A piece of legislation like that would have gone to a committee, a select committee to discuss. Because it has implications for other religions as well. Today it is Saturday and Sunday. But are you going to legislate for Rastafarian to smoke their weed when they have in there? Are you going to get there too? Because you're talking about religious observance. That is why Ellen G. White, as well as John F. Kennedy, say, keep it separate. You cannot legislate morality. You cannot do that. Politics finished, you won the election, you trick people that you dress like a priest. That's it. You won. Now it is time to govern the country. Stop playing games. Do not use this parliament for that. Do not use the parliament for that. Mr. President, I truly believe that we are on the wrong path with this government. And I'm calling St. Lucians, both here and abroad, to pay attention critically to what is happening. I know what I say here will not make the news. I know that because there's a certain silence in this country. A certain silence. People are afraid to speak. But you know, is it Dalai Lama who said, no, Martin Luther King Jr. who said, the day you decide to remain silent on the thing that matters is the day you start to die. So yes, say yeah, labor, you're over there. Remain silent, stay quiet, roll with it, and see where we will end up. You may have a reason for remaining quiet. Of course, you did not like Dr. Kenny Anthony, you say you did not like so-and-so, you do not like labor. But these things should not happen. You know what could happen? It takes another administration of different people one day to come and amend that same legislation to add and to bring things, and all of a sudden you have persecution upon the very people that you're trying to serve. That piece of legislation have no business, because we have a constitution that protects the rights of persons and give us freedom of conscience, freedom of religion. It is in the constitution. Do not legislate an act to pretend that you're giving churches something and you know it is just a game for politics. My heart says that I should say brother. My mind tells me otherwise. Because sometimes, Mr. President, I ask myself when I come into this house, when I first have decided, I'm only less than 2 years in as a politician. I have more than 25 years as a quantity surveyor and as a professional. I believe in bricks and mortar. And therefore, I think logically. I cannot help it. So I'm asking myself, is this the hypocrisy of politics? If so, then our science children should design some sort of a chemical to spray inside her before we have a Senate meeting. Just like you spray for mosquitoes so that hypocrites do not come in. But please do not spray it in the churches, for you may not have persons to come. But I'm telling you, this is hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. And we're taking it too far. I sat in the gallery during the presentation of this piece of legislation, and the member for Castries South is signal and said, why the debate? And I signal, why bring this here? This have no business being in this house. And for persons in this house who are God fearing should not allow themselves to be driven into a cause of a business that have no use inside of here. History may come back to haunt you. And you may regret the day you said yes to this piece of legislation. I do not need the government to help me keep the Sabbath. I will keep the Sabbath. I do not need the government to pass laws to tell me not to commit adultery. I do not need the government to pass laws to tell me not to steal. I do not need the government to pass laws. Maybe they need to pass some laws for some other things inside of her. But like the Pharisees in time of old, we ignore what is before us. We ignore what faces us, and then we go after something that doesn't even trouble us. Guess what? If you believe it was malicious on the part of the Labour Party to put nomination day on Saturday, then it is your time to put nomination day. As a matter of fact, it is so many years away. Maybe you're not, I'm not right about that, but so I think. And therefore, it is your occasion to set nomination day. Prove to us that you will not make the error that you say Dr. Kenny Anthony made. There are so many other laws, religious liberty, so many young Seventh-day Adventist persons who do not get job because of their day of worship. You could not come and look and discuss how to strengthen the work environment to have equal rights. There are some people who still do not employ people because they have their dreadlocks. Under your government, you cut their dreadlocks like joke when you used to arrest them. It's their symbol of their religion. You left all of that and you rush in to pass a piece of legislation for Sabbath keeping. You understand? You will say it's not about Sabbath keeping, but the spirit of the legislation. You see, sometimes somebody will come and say, but this piece of document looks so simple and straightforward. There's nothing in it. It's just to say nomination day will not fall on Saturday and Sunday and holidays. No. You have to listen to the spirit of the discussion. The spirit behind the legislation have to deal with religion. And sometimes that is why we find ourselves as to what is this doing on the books? What is that there? And at what time will you legislate for the Arabs and other persons who are likely to be in our midst? And at what time that all our days become days of worship for one person or the other? Do you legislate for that as well? You cannot. The Bible says, let everyone be persuaded in his own mind. And to whom that knoweth to do good, let him do it. As a matter of fact, I know, I am overwhelmed because I know the scriptures too well. As a Seventh Adventist, we used to read the Bible upside down. 7 days, they said a week. So I know it. I'm overwhelmed by the fact that we're bringing a piece of legislation that is anti-Christianity. And if you tell me, would the Catholics applaud the effort? Of course not. Because the jazz, the other activities we have may be affecting our days of worship more than nomination day, which is just a few politicians who are going to get nominated. The other thing is, Mr. President, I spent a lot of time on the National Community Foundation Board. I worked almost 10 years with Father Michel, where we planned telethon and other activities. And it was very interesting over these 10 years how Father Michel dealt with the activities that he did not like on Sundays, how he dealt with it. And I forever, while that presentation was being made, I continued to replay our exchanges at the board meeting with Father Michel. And I said, wow, why should we do that? There are people who already said that's hypocrisy. Who did you consult on this? I spoke with the president of the St. Lucian Mission. He was not consulted. A piece of legislation that's going to deal with churches, you did not consult any one of them. No, this was the politicians deciding what the church needs. Since when that's your role? Since when's that your role? What the church needs, that's your role? To give them more time to go to church? Mr. President, mwen ka dou sa fè mwen la pen. Mwen ka dou sa kwaze chè mwen. Gouvernement sa la pani piyes lan mitye pou pep set misi. Paske sa mwen ka wè yo ka fè a, se pou detwi kilte nou, detwi sa ki an nou pou nou ay duvan. There's a need for us to come together. I went to some of the activities, the prayers and the supplication that's supposed to be like sweet perfume going up to heaven. Nothing is consistent with what we do in here today. You want a country to come together? Stop the politics. You won the election, stop it. As a matter of fact, the member from Castries South said, thank God he did not break the Sabbath because he was able to follow God's commandment and still win handsomely. I lost the election. Why change the legislation? Because he said he was able to keep the Sabbath. He did not break the Sabbath. The man did not break the Sabbath. But you said it hindered. How it hindered him? Come on. St. Lucians know better. Let us not make use of the House, the Senate, for mockery and to ridicule St. Lucians. There are intelligent people out there that do not believe what we're saying. If you speak to some people behind closed doors or when they're not on the radio, they will tell you, yeah, that's hypocrisy. And I will not lead any parliament in any matter of this House, from any side, into anything that's against my conscience. God first, I obey. Where I have my struggles, God first. You do not need to legislate for me to do what's good. Our children should know what's good from their home. You do not need to legislate for them to know what's good. But sadly, even grown men that know what they're supposed to do, good, doing the wrong things. Who you blame? The law? So the bad things that's going on in the social media, we need to legislate for it too, to tell grown men how to behave. We have to do that too. You know, Mr. President, we have a country that is sick. People are dying. People have their concerns about where they're going to get their food. People are concerned about their rights. People are concerned about a number of issues. Of course we are a Christian nation and we believe in God. And we believe through our trials, through our tests, our daily struggles, even with this government, that we have the hope that we'll overcome. But this side needs to provide leadership because they're the ones leading. They need to provide leadership. And when you provide leadership, the essence of leadership is followership. You do things that person could follow. The essence of leadership is not management. The essence of leadership is followership. People follow the leader. And it is a task in our society for leaders to emerge. Leadership is not an easy task. It's not an easy role to perform when you're in a leadership position. It's not easy. You have to sometimes do the things that you do not even like, but for the sake of the majority and the good. But where conscience is concerned, majority do not rule, because you personally have to take responsibility for your action. In closing, Mr. President, if I have not, and I'll try to bring this thing to logical conclusion. You know, as a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, and I do not say this boastfully, because sometimes, you know, I have to confess with my kids, when it was time for me to go and get nominated for nomination, and I listened to the explanation of what happened, I listened to everybody speak. I listened to my wife, I listened to my friends, I listened to the pastor. I knew it was a decision for me to make, another difficult decision to make. You know what was good about my conclusion? In life, we'll always have difficult decisions to make, because life is never meant for us to make easy decisions. But the decision is not whether I would go and get whether I would participate in the election. I would participate, but how do I go and get nominated based on the fact that it's Saturday? The majority of people who are Seventh-day Adventists who wanted me to win tell me not to go because some Seventh-day Adventists will not vote for me. That I could not give them. I do not want to lead people just for people to vote for me. When you are in a leadership position, you need to stand beyond that. I decided to participate because I thought what I was doing was right. And I want to lead. I do not want people to follow in the wrong way. So I went and I did so. And I remember my great-grandmother telling me who swept the Catholic Marshall Church. Because before I was a Seventh Adventist, I spent all my time going to the Catholic Church at Marshall. My great-grandmother Mafatal was the one who swept the church and received Holy Communion from the Catholic Church until her passing. And she always said to me, being her only grandson, that I am always right and she trusts my judgment. She tells me that she trusts my judgment because every time I had a problem, I had to consult her. And I believe there are times when you do not know where to go, you need to make a decision and move forward. The Seventh-day Adventist people believe in the freedom of their religion and freedom to practice their religion. They do not need a society that legislating just for politicians to go and participate in politics. They would like to know when they go to work, they are treated equally and they get a fair job just like anybody else, and nobody prevents them from getting a job because of the Sabbath. That is what the leaders of this parliament should do. Not to pass law for you to pass in parliament. And I know persons here, Seventh-day Adventists, when they participated, on the Saturday they went and buy their own umbrellas. I tell you, Mr. President, we need to spray the house with a spray for hypocrites. Spray it. They do something else, but they come and say something else. I live my life that I do not want my children to say, hey, look, daddy did not go and get nominated. But if the dogs were barking at the back of the house, he would go and attend to them. So many things I would go and attend to on the Sabbath day. I don't want anybody to look at me as a hypocrite. Who you see here today is who I am and how I'd like to stand. I would love to serve St. Lucia in truth, in sincerity, and with everything that I know to be right. When I'm corrected, I will do different. So until then, my pastors over in Jamaica, my pastors here in St. Lucia, some of them that I spoke with, said to me, brother, it's a decision you need to make. I cannot tell you not to do it. I think so. The other brother did it another way. Of course I accepted. But when he said he did not break the Sabbath, I said, what? The Sabbath commandment did not leave room for you to send anybody else. It said, not thy manservant, not thy maidservant, not thy cattle, not thy strangers that within thy gates. How else could you go and do it? You have to face the music. You can't send somebody else to sin for you if you believe it's sin. And the law of love says, if you break one, you're guilty of all. When you reconcile all of that together, how could you come and say and make that big pretense in the House of Parliament? Against that, we cannot forget. We cannot forget. Your building blocks of development of this country is to bring religion in a compromised position. Because you visited all churches. All churches. Mr. President, I respect churches. I didn't even want to go to the schools. I did not. I wrote a letter. I felt, a kind of way restricted as to where I could go and where I should go. I go in communities. I can't go into a Catholic church as a Seventh-day Adventist during election and stand by the people doors greeting people who invited me. I respect churches too much to do that. I did not. I called the priest on the phone and tell him, what can I do? Maybe these are some other laws we need to put in the election thing as to where we should go and where we should not go. As against seeing as if the church is you, our politicians going everywhere, we la nula tupatu, kapekisa, katrai kwenemun. I'm not on that. So I called. I told, even when I went to Seventh-day Adventist churches that I do not usually go, I felt uncomfortable. Because it's disturbing people's worship, Mr. President, as a Seventh-day Adventist. When you're not expecting somebody to be in your church and they appear, the first thing everybody turn back and say, who is there? And even when they do not turn back, they ask, who is there? So-and-so is there. Well, of course, people might get off the worship, say, politics. So I am careful not to. But that's what you did during the campaign. Spread, toute l'église. Something I just planned, sir. Then after that, your leader went and he presented himself. The Pope. Well, you know what this constitution says, specifically? That no religious minister cannot be a member of the parliament. No religious minister. The constitution says that you cannot be a member of this parliament. Well, of course, we know the influence of the church. So you know you cannot be a minister and be in this church. So you present yourself as, you mock the church. You put the thing on you. You had holy water. You have little children following you. Tacky. So who does that? Who does that? Then you now in government, you win. You have to double up on it. So you pass in this piece of legislation. And then you have people saying, oh, the church does better under us. You want to identify with that piece of that statement that the church does better under you? On this side? I know you're not comfortable with that statement. And you do not want to identify with that statement. I know that. And not because you're in the same party, you have to associate with the person that you cannot say, look, I disassociate with that statement. This statement is not good. This is bringing politics in the churches where people worship. And when people go to their churches, they're uncomfortable with their leaders because a member of parliament in the house said that the churches are better under them. We don't do that. This is the Senate. This is the upper house. And we're supposed to bring a certain amount of reasoning. What do you do? You want to proceed with this piece of legislation that has implications for the future? Or should you send that to a select committee where we can have constructive discussion, where we can ask that this thing be revisited by the lower house? You are setting history by passing this piece of legislation in this house. By the amendments of this piece of legislation, you would be sending down in future a host of things that you probably would regret. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, I just say it in that vein. I ask you to reconsider and send this thing to a select committee. Let us not be consumed by the color of our thinking, but by the cells in our brain. That everything that flows is blood and true blood, that we are sons and daughters of St. Lucia, and we care about St. Lucia, and not be led by the whims and fancies of some politicians who have no interest in the holistic development of this country, but just to endure power for a moment. If we can find it within us to move in this direction, we would be sending a signal to everybody that this Senate means business. If we continue to just rubber stamp and move with the flow, I tell you, tomorrow will be our cry. There comes a time when we need to stand. And I think today is the day we need to stand for St. Lucia and for the goodness of our people. Thank you, Mr. President, for your patience. Thank you very much.